Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, thank you. Good night, Fyzabad. Party Chairman and Minister of Energy, Mr. Franklin Khan, my cabinet colleague and former Member of Parliament for Point Fortin, which is Paula Gopi-Skoon, Deputy Political Leader of the People's National Movement, Mrs. Joan Yule-Williams, other party officers, PNM standard bearers for the Corporation of Pinal, Debe, and Siparia, members of the community of Fyzabad, visitors here to Fyzabad, fellow citizens listening at home, welcome to the PNM's local government reform exercise as we move to the polls on November 28, 2016. This is local government time. I've heard the record, and I just want to put your minds at ease. I can't recall ever shaking the hand of the former Prime Minister. What I do know is that she brought Vanilla Allen Topping to kiss me. I didn't shake anybody's hand. I didn't kiss anybody. What I do know is that they got Ian Allen to find a woman to turn her back to the camera and accuse me of all crimes and misdemeanors. But after all of that, like Hillary Clinton, I did not shake her hand. So that's one hurdle that we've crossed. But tonight, I stand before you here in this very prestigious and historic location, which we call Charlie King Junction, to remind you that the PNM is the country's premier political institution. This year, we are celebrating 60 years as a political party in Trinidad and Tobago. When we came into being in 1956, there were many people in the country who felt that what existed was all we were worth and all that could happen. But the founding father of the PNM, Dr. Eric Eustace Williams, a historian and a patriot, he knew that we could be better. He knew not just as Trinidad and Tobago, but as a region, we could be better. And he didn't only know that, he was prepared to challenge the status quo. Dr. Williams was a regional leader. He was a regional thinker. He was a regional historian. And he saw many decades ahead where, if there was a Caribbean nation, a Caribbean federation, how much better we as a people would be in Trinidad and Tobago and the Caribbean. And we became a federation, but the federation did not survive. There was a referendum in Jamaica. Jamaica pulled out. There were 10 of us in the Caribbean in that federation. Jamaica pulled out. And Dr. Williams did the famous computation. 1 from 10 leaves North. And that was the end of the federation. But he said that Trinidad and Tobago could grow it as an independent nation. He, being our first chief minister, our first prime minister, undertook to take us to independence. And the record will show that there were people in Trinidad and Tobago who believed that independence was not the way to go. We were taking on too much. We couldn't govern ourselves, and so on and so on and so on. But Dr. Williams and the PNM in 1962 convinced the majority of people in this country that Trinidad and Tobago could and should become an independent nation. And we went on to accept that onerous responsibility under the PNM's guidance. And today, you can hardly find one person who would seriously in Trinidad and Tobago say that they prefer colonial status than the status we enjoy today of the Independent Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. And then we became a republic where we refused to accept the Queen as our head of state, and we established, for better or for worse, that we will cut ties with Buckingham Palace and place our hope at the up north of the savannah, where Ellis Clark and others would be our head of state. Today, I ask you to see our history in that same context, that change for the better is to be embraced, and that the PNM knows about change, and we have made changes for the better in this country. When we came into office, there was the city of Port of Spain as the only city in Trinidad. Then we now speak about the city of San Fernando, and the people of San Fernando understand that their status as a city is quite different to what they had before. The current Minister of Local Government, incidentally, his father, Raki Hossein, was the last mayor of San Fernando when San Fernando was a borough. And Minister Hossein today was the last mayor of the city of San Fernando. Today, the people of Point Fortin and Arima speak proudly of their borough status, administrative entities within Trinidad and Tobago, and the people of Chaguanas will not trade their borough status. I am saying to you tonight that if we do as we did before, be confident in our future, and we are prepared to accept responsibility for ourselves, before I leave office as Prime Minister of Trinidad and Tobago, I hope one day to be officiating somewhere or seeing someone officiate and speak about the borough of Siparia, the borough of Fyzabad, and the city of Chaguanas. This I will not resist, nor will the PNM. We hold it out to you that if that is your dream too, that is where local government is going in Trinidad and Tobago. Because governance by townships will bring to you greater accountability, greater responsibility, and an improved quality of life. Because at the end of the day, it is all about an improved quality of life. And you only get that if you use the resources available to you in the best possible way. I'm from Diego Martin, the MP for Diego Martin. Maybe very soon, we'll have the borough of Diego Martin. And we move towards a centralized authority in Diego Martin, and maybe the mayor of Diego Martin. The chief administrator, who, like the chief secretary in Tobago, will be held accountable by the people of the district for what goes on in the district. Go to Tobago now, and everybody in Tobago knows that the chief secretary in Tobago is Orville London, and if the administration of Tobago is falling and failing, the person you hold accountable is the chief secretary. And when you get to that stage of governance and look back to where we came from as a country, you'll understand what kind of progress we can make. So you see, local government in 2016 is not being held out to you as an election ploy. We sat down when we were in the opposition. That's why the PNM does the most of its thinking and the best of its ideas come up in opposition. And then we plan and prepare for when we are in government, because we always expect to be in government. Even when we lose an election, we hand over power in a decent and peaceful way, and we make our way to the opposition, and we plan and we prepare. As Prime Minister today, I have served 2 terms in the opposition, and sometimes I tell my current members of parliament who are ministers who are not experienced in government, I say, maybe you aren't as educated as you should be, because the best education you could get to be a minister or to be in government is to spend some time in the opposition. So you see, the PNM has a history of doing that. Going in the opposition, planning and preparing, and this time was no different. While we were in the opposition, we used our internal intellect, we invited people from outside of the party and the public servants, and we set about with all those who will cooperate first with us, and we created a plan for when we get into government. So when we wrote our manifesto, before we offered ourselves to you in the 2015 election, we documented our position on the next step with respect to local government. And then we got into government with your support, and we became the government. And in 12 months, we were able to conduct and complete and analyze the widest consultation process that ever took place in Trinidad and Tobago. Minister Franklin Khan led that charge. And we conducted 14 of the best and the most open and transparent consultations where we came to you as a people. And we asked you, what do you want as against what we said should happen? And we listened to you and we documented it. And now we have distilled that and we are now in a position to convert what you want into law. And very soon you'll see the legislation on its way to Parliament. But in the meantime, the existing council comes to an end. And on the very day the council came to an end, we ended the council's term and we called an election for November 28th. And we're prepared to go forward with that process. After you vote us and our councillors into office on November 28th, the process continues through legislation. And we'll break some bonds and we'll break some ties and we'll create new situations and new structures. So the next three-year period of local government will be the most exciting and hardworking in our time. I mentioned to you a while ago that we conducted that nationwide, except for Tobago. In fact, we did go to Tobago because we went to Tobago to talk to them about how their system is working, to learn from them. Where there is good, where there is indifferent, to be able to fashion Trinidad's in a more workable way using Tobago's 36 years of experience. That whole process cost less than $2 million. Would you believe that? The PNM consulting with the country on this matter cost us less than $2 million. Before that, there was a consultation on electoral reform led by Prakash Ramadan, cost $15 million. And all that came out of it was that on the verge of the election, something that was not part of the consultation was rammed through the parliament. Nowhere in that consultation of the previous government was there any talk about runoff and rundown and run up. We got up one morning and heard Mrs. Kamala Prasad Bisesa and the cabal, who had seen an electoral defeat coming, went to the parliament and ran through night and day with demonstrators outside, objecting, even members of the commission itself, persons who took part in the consultation as commissioners. They came to the parliament to say, we did not deal with that. Where did that come from? And the UNC said, we don't care, we're going to ram it through the parliament. And with a handful of the friends as independent senators, they passed something into law about runoff. Where if you don't get this, you don't get that, you don't get that. Total confusion. The end result was, it came to naught. Even as they passed it into law, in the face of public disquiet and public objection, they went through the process using their majority in the parliament, but insofar as it came as an exercise for electoral advancement in this country, at the end of the day, it came to naught. At worst, the election was upon us. And they took every single day that was possible, the entire 3 months, to convince you that you should put them back into power. But the people of Trinidad and Tobago did not. The PNM won a handsome victory of a clear majority in the parliament. And instead of accepting the PNM's defeat, PNM's victory and their own defeat, like Donald Trump, they said they will only accept the result if they win. Thankfully for America, Trump won. And thankfully for Trinidad and Tobago, the PNM won. But even as we won, what did we get from them? Gone to the courthouse to say that they must declare 6 of the seats vacant. And their leader come down here to you in Sipari and Fyzabad and tell you, keep your yellow jersey, we're going back to the polls because the court gonna declare 6 of the PNM seats vacant. So don't throw me out as leader, please don't throw me out. We haven't finished with the election and we're gonna win the 6 seats. And a handful of people in Sipari believe that foolishness, you know. And 2 or 3 of you here in Fyzabad believe that nonsense, you know. So they've gone to the court to ask the court to overthrow an election when every high school child could see that the law says, the law, the constitution says, that if there is any shenanigan in an election in this country, the election results can only be overturned if whatever you're complaining about is material in changing the election result, and only then can a court overturn the result. And guess what? We beat them by 3,000 votes in San Fernando. 240 votes were cast in the last hour. We say if we give you all the votes in the last hour, you still lose. They're still going to court, say they're a senior counsel, and guess what? The court say the elections were free and fair, and the PNM win them in the east, in the west, in the north, and the south. And you know, when the court said that, they say we didn't go to court to get the seats changed, you know. We just went to court to prove that the EBC had no power to do that. This is the only country in the world where the election commission was ever challenged for facilitating people voting. Everywhere else in the world, when there's a challenge to a commission, it is because they try to prevent people from voting. But they think we forget them. And they now have to face a situation. Do they accept and support what the country is doing? Not the PNM, the country. The country's progress, that we move towards local government reform and new arrangements. You see, governance is important. Because if you have resources and you don't have a good governance structure, then the resources may never be available to give you the quality of life that we're hankering after. You may never have enough resources to give you even the basics. So we are saying that we of the PNM, we can demonstrate to you and justify to you why you should support a PNM candidate in your district. Because the PNM has a record, a known and proven record of doing well and of improving our circumstance and of making the most of whatever we have available. The PNM's record stands there unchallenged. And every standard bearer here tonight and across Trinidad in the coming election carries that commitment and that record that the PNM has in this country. So when you go to the polls and you have an option of voting for another candidate, and there's a PNM candidate, that option is whose record can stand scrutiny. For too long, especially in recent times, the population of this country has been encouraged not to believe and accept the word of those in office, and to begin to believe and accept that what people say to you has no meaning or is not the truth. But under my stewardship of this PNM government, I want to guide you, the population, back to a place where, regardless of the consequences, you must be able to accept official statements and accept the word of the Prime Minister and accept the word of the ministers of government, especially when they talk in Parliament. Because when you have good governance, that is taken as a given. Starting with who you put in Parliament and who you make Prime Minister and who you make Minister. And that is why recently I was a little disturbed when I spoke to this country as Prime Minister, as openly as I could, about my own health and my own medical concerns. And there were those in the country who felt they couldn't believe it and they couldn't accept it, because somehow they had become accustomed so much to leadership lying to the country, that when I said to this country that I'm going to have medical examination on Monday and Tuesday, take Wednesday and Thursday as a vacation, and come back here the following Monday, for 2 weeks, this country couldn't digest that. It was too simple, too straightforward, too honest, and too unaccustomed. So when we say to you now that the government is going to go ahead with local government reform, having opened the doors to you to participate, being held out to you as to what will happen against what kind of time frame and what kind of benefits we can expect. I expect that we'll begin to use the trust in governance to understand that we can trust those from the PNM who tell us what is going to happen. And when we put those in place, it will then fall to you, the burgesses, to hold people accountable, to not elect scamps and crooks, do not encourage liars in office, and to not elect people and encourage people who believe that they come into office to serve themselves, and who believe that office is to benefit them and their family. It is for you to identify who is about public service for the public, who is about developing your region, who is about taking pride in your children's future, who is about making more with less. And when you do that, you can only come to the one conclusion that the only political party that offers you the best chance for that kind of situation is the People's National Movement. You heard Mr. Franklin Khan a moment ago mention OAS. Well, let me tell you what I heard. I was in the parliament when we exposed to the parliament something that this country did not know. Because until you voted the PNM into office and gave us access to the files and the authority to examine, you, the people of Trinidad and Tobago, did not know that the largest contract ever awarded in the history of this country for $5,200,000,000, that contract, written in legal document, had a protection for you, the people. And that protection is this, that if the company that you gave all this money to, if that company goes bankrupt, then you could intervene with no questions asked and fire the company off the job. That was written in the contract. But right on the week of election, knowing what might happen on election day, and in protection of the contractor, which had become bankrupt long before in Brazil, and they were encouraged here to receive taxpayers' money, Mrs. Kamala Prasad Bisesa and her minister and the cabal led by Rambachan as Minister of Works oversaw through NIDCO a removal of that protection clause from the contract as a legal amendment. Legally removed from the contract of your $5 billion exposure so that the contractor may not be removed because the contractor was bankrupt. I ask you tonight whether you have GC, BSc, MSc, PhD, but just basic common sense. What in God's name was that government doing removing that clause from that contract, and how could that benefit you? The only person who stands to benefit from that was the contractor, whom the government could not now remove for bankruptcy. So your money dancing up in steel band. But then you, the people, intervened and put another government in office. You put the PNM in office. Because power always lies with the people. My grandmother always taught me, you could do as much, but not as long. So the PNM comes into office, and we find this shocking discovery of this removal of the clause of this contract. And they believe that that was going to protect the contractor to remain there and receive taxpayers' money and punch with the contract for another 10 years and all of them happy. But this PNM government that you elected and the ministers that I appointed, they went to work on that contract. And within short order, very legally and very properly, we fired the contractor. And you see, there was another protection that you had. When the contractor got the contractor had to put up bonds in cash with banks, saying to you, the people, if we don't perform on this contract, you can be rewarded by this cash coming back to you. So when we fired the contractor, We call any contractor to continue. Contractor can't continue because, as you know, long before the election, the contractor had stopped working. Stop paying subcontractors, stop paying workers, and so on and so on. So when we call on the contractor to continue, and the contractor could not continue, we fired the contractor, and we called the bonds. And you know what? The banks where the bonds were, the cash, started to fight us. Minister Stuart Young tonight, I want to congratulate him. He went to the banks, and he went to London, and we came to Brazil, and we fought them, and we won all the cases, and today we have recovered $1,000 million from that contract. And I'm putting it to you tonight that had you not voted the PNM into office, the same way they removed the clause from the contract to protect the contractor, they would have protected that bond and you would never have got a cent back. So when we got up in the parliament to advise you that we have won the case in London, the last one was last week, Thursday, I think it was, and we got the last $200 million, Rambachan is going to look me in the face and say, "You all don't crow, we would have do that too." The same man who oversaw the removal of the clause to protect the bankrupt Brazilian contractor that charged in Brazil for corruption, saying to us, they were going to go for the money too. So you who would not have fired the contractor, you would have gone for the bonds. But hallelujah, we have the cash in hand. And under the legal processes, the contractor is now claiming for arbitration. Well, let's go to arbitration and let the arbitrator say how much of the $1 billion you could get back. But in the meantime, the people of Trinidad and Tobago, we pull the clause and we claim the money. And then we're going to restart the project. But on the basis that there were people in authority in this country, led by Mrs. Kamla Prasad Bisesa, who had the gall and the lack of decency and the lack of commitment to you, the people of Fyzabad and all of Trinidad and Tobago, to oversee the removal of a clause from a contract to protect a contractor in that way, on November 28th, I heard a chief the slogan from the MSJ, that the MSJ borrowed from the PNM. Well, I want you to send a message to them and do not cast a single vote for a single candidate led by Mrs. Kamla Prasad Bisesa. That would be your response to what I just told you. Because if you vote for them, you are actually saying to them, I am happy with what you have done. I'm encouraging you in this, and I want you to represent us. People of Trinidad and Tobago, we are talking here about good governance. And if there is champishness, if there is theft, if there is corruption, you cannot have good governance in that situation. And any person, any organization that make that the way of life, and you take public money and expose it in that way, then you have no business expecting to succeed in Fyzabad, in Siparia, in Pinal, or anywhere else. You see, that same contract, the contractor being notorious for corrupting people because their principals have been arrested in Brazil for corruption. And unless you believe that they're only corrupt in Brazil and they will not be corrupt in Trinidad, then you can believe that if you wish. But I asked Mrs. Kamla Prasad Bisesa on many occasions which of her ministers were sitting in a hotel room in South Africa on a particular day at the Michelangelo Hotel when that contract was being discussed. And she never answered that question for 4 years. Never once did she answer the question. The same way when I ask her, what is the liability for closing down the aluminum smelter? She never answered. Never answered that. A prime minister of this country, opposition leader asking her about $1 billion expenses. Not a sound. Not a sound. But she was busy recruiting Vanilla Allen to come to parliament to slander me and my father. And Mullal had a big banner across the road here in Fyzabad or Rapuch telling you to protect your children from me. But I want to protect you from Kamla Prasad Bisesa and Rudal Munilal. And listen, I am simply saying to you what the facts are. And I defy any of them to say what I have told you is not true. And then you are free to go and cast a vote. Whether you're casting the vote based on geography, because all of them down here together, or you all look alike, you all the same religion, the same race, the same family, the same whatever it is, you go and vote for them, that is your right. I am simply stating to you the facts and ask you to make an appropriate, responsible judgment as a citizen of Trinidad and Tobago. That's all. And I have every confidence that the People's National Movement is by far and away a superior offering as an institution in the political arena. You see, we are not in times of plenty. We did know times of plenty. But every country has its ups and downs. I remember when I was a student in England, in the 1970s, they were going through just what we are going through here now. The economy was collapsing, the unions were in disarray, the government was in disarray, the future looked bleak, but there was North Sea oil. And the British rebuilt themselves on North Sea oil. They borrowed and they did that and so on and so on, and they rebuilt themselves. All countries go through that. We are now going through some difficult times. Overnight, we've lost a significant amount of our earnings because, one, there has been significant collapse in the price of our main exports. Don't let nobody fool you. All those who are promising to give more and more, and we would have give and we would have give, don't let that fool you. We are in no position to behave as though these things have not happened. The price of oil has fallen way down from 100 to 28 and back up to 30 and is now leveling out somewhere in the $44, $43 a barrel. And when you hear that, we are not getting $44 a barrel. Eh? Because our oil is of a lower quality, largely, we're getting less. But the benchmark price that we're using is the WTI that is published. So we have to accept, and we think we know by now, that we have lost because of price collapse in oil and in gas. So that also had a knock-on in the other commodities. As much as 60% of what we were earning is no longer available. So anybody who holds out to you that we would have do this and we would have do that are people to just ignore. But of course, not having the same amount of resources, but making do and making the best of what we have, when we compare it with what we were doing before, the report has just shown that the decline between the two periods is about 6.7%. I know there are those who will, oh my Lord, the sky has fallen in and it's the PNM fault. I want to remind you that when the PNM came into office, we met this situation. We didn't bring it. We met it worse than this. And we spent the last year holding the ship together. Had the PNM not been in office, I guarantee you that the circumstances would have been far different. Because by the time they done teeth the 2016 amount, it would have had precious little for you. I am proud as Prime Minister to have sat in the Parliament in the last budget debate after the Kamala Prasad cabal five-year rampage, where every day was a scandal. Every day was who was thieving what. Every day who was becoming millionaire of what, and so on and so on and so on. And I sat there and I watched them trying to bust Mark on the PNM government. The three of them came with marks to bust, and that was supposed to be their budget debate. Never engaged the numbers, never engaged the circumstances, never engaged the work program. They were all about busting Mark. Bust Mark and say what? The Ministry of Transport give a $200 million contract to somebody, and Rambachan took his 45 minutes detailing that scandal. Guess what? Turned out it was all a lie. What it was that since we bought the Tobago ferries, was it 10 years, we've been paying the people who we bought the ferries from some umpteen, I think it's $6 million a year to drive them. So you know, you buy a car from Neil and Massey, and then you're paying Massey to drive the car. And you pay them more for the driving than the car. So after 10 years, we, this nation, that bought planes from BOAC and create BB since I was a little boy, and fly planes with the safest record anywhere in the world, over 50 years of flying, we can't drive a boat to Tobago. We got to pay the vendor $6 million USA to drive it. So this government set about under a new board to change that and to put locals in charge of operating the ferry. And the opposition comes to the parliament and lies on the government and say that we are involved in corruption. That was Rambachan Mark that went flat. But before that, you had the former prime minister who is now opposition leader. She had 3 hours to talk in the parliament. She spent 1 hour trying to tell you that Jerry Brooks that we put in NGC involved in some scheme with Ansa Makal, and Ansa Makal go and take over and the new share one set of rubbish. And the next day, the Guardian gave her a front page editorial for talking foolishness. And there was one more, I can't remember what it was. There was another one from, there were three of them. There was another one. But we came out of that debate, and there was not a single credible allegation of any wrongdoing on the part of a single government in Trinidad and Tobago. And therefore, this country is heading in the right direction. After she was in office for 1 year, there was enough scandal to fool this whole book. We have passed 1 year, and we are safely on a journey to the port of good governance. And you know, they can't control their business in their own house, but they want to make mischief in the PNM. There was a cabinet reshuffle in the PNM, and they talk more about the PNM reshuffle than of all the 15 that they had in their time. A PNM reshuffle where PNM members have been put in different positions. I don't know that PNM members asked Mrs. Prasad Bisesa and the UNC and Ralph Barrage for any help. I don't know that. Because when all my members came and we took them up to Otinola, before they were candidates, Mrs. Williams was there, she will tell you, I stood before them and told them, what you all are offering yourself for is to represent the people of your district. You are not running for minister. And anybody who believes that what the government is paying is not enough, leave now. And I paused for them to leave, and nobody left. So we have contracted arrangements with PNM members. So if today a PNM prime minister for the moment moves a minister from point A to point B, he does so with the agreement and understanding of that contract that we have. What you have become accustomed to is a prime minister bargaining with people, and you end up with every member of the last cabal as a minister of government blackmailing the prime minister. And even that didn't work. Even that didn't work. Because at the end of the day, you're either a good government or you're a bad government. So tonight, we are offering you good governance down from central government into local government. We are offering you the opportunity to grasp with both hands the responsibility for running Fyzabad as a township and running Siparia as a township, being a part of the larger whole, but doing what happens in Fyzabad better than anybody else can do. Who can do better in Fyzabad than the people of Fyzabad? Who can do better for Siparia in Siparia than the people of Siparia? So we are saying decentralize the government from Port of Spain into your district, and the resources that come to you, those who will manage those resources, you will know who they are and you will hold them accountable. That is the only way we can improve and go forward. If we don't do that, the elections will be the same like the one 2013 and the ones before. You have an election day, you vote some councillors into office, and some of them might only be interested in a contract, a petty contract, and fixing their family and friends. I know that you know some contractors, some councillors in this district who after election day had no interest in service. They know that their party will win the next time because it's a stronghold of so and so and so, so they don't have to serve you. send a message to such persons in starting here in Siparia, in the Siparia Corporation, starting with the top, starting with the chairman. Send a message to them that you didn't come to serve yourself and to help yourself. You had come to serve Siparia people. And since you have failed to do those things that you ought to have done, and you have done those things that you ought not to have done, come November 28th, you will vote for the People's National Movement. We have no fear in offering you greater autonomy, because we have seen it work. Even where there was trepidation on the parts of some, or even opposition on the parts of some, we have seen that over time, such persons who have been given and who received that, they are now saying that the system works and there's a greater confidence. Fyzabad, those of you who go to Tobago, I'm sure you will come back here satisfied that Tobago is well-run, clean, green and serene, and is developing the way you would like Fyzabad to develop. And if it could happen in Tobago, it should and must happen here in Fyzabad and in Siparia and elsewhere. You must remember, at one time, Tobago was the backwater of this country. Tobago, if you talk about being away from the center of power and from development, it was Tobago. But in a short 3 decades, Tobago has moved to the forefront, where now, as Minister Khan says, the burgesses in Tobago somehow treats the THA election as more important than the national election, because they have now learned and they understand that it is those people who look after their lives on the ground in front of them who are important to their quality of life. And such persons will not now trade the THA for anything they had before. And if you take time to go on the phone and call them and talk to them, even if they have arguments or disgruntlement about certain things, specific things, but overall, the governance structure and the progress and the accountability is there, and that is what you are after. It's not personal. We're not dealing with personalities here. We're dealing with structure and systems, and we are also dealing with character. Put people of character into office. Take people of bad character out of office. And you have to be a person of bad character to have gone and used taxpayers' money in the way you have done, and to go into the contract and remove taxpayer protection, and then expect to come here and ask you to vote them back into authority. How do they see you? When they ask you to do that, they think you don't know, they think you don't believe, or they think you're just plain stupid. Nobody is entitled to your vote. We have the PNM, we earn your vote. We've earned it for the last 60 years. When you don't give it to us, we respect it. We come again and we come better, and this time we're red and we're ready. I want to say something to the young people of Fyzabad. I know there are many, many of you here tonight and many of you listening, and Fyzabad has a beautiful cadre of young people that I always admire. Young people, those of us who are adults, we have already got the best of what this country had to offer to our generation. What you are required to do is to come forward and demand that you get the best of what the future holds out to you, and that future is the PNM. Because if you don't do that, if you don't come out and join with the PNM to protect your future, what little we have going into the future, you may very well find that you may not be able to enjoy what we, the elders, enjoyed when this country was properly run. And nowadays, everybody in Trinidad and Tobago begin to take everything for granted. Take governance for granted, take success for granted, take failure for granted, take crime for granted. No country can ever progress when we take things for granted. Everything has a cause and an effect. Corruption has a cause, and the effect is a loss of asset, is a loss of what should be used to develop. And of course, a small minority will prosper. Last week, a former PNM minister had his house levied upon for non-payment of his mortgage, and he was evicted from his house. It's a sad story. And I know that there are some of you who will see it as a sad story. But in that story is a message. And that message is, he was exposed as a minister, and he left as a minister. And I don't know that he had enough money to pay his mortgage, so he lost his house. Bonnie Padmore and Hugh Francis and Cutty Joseph and Eric Williams were PNM ministers. I don't know that they enriched themselves with office. Can you say the same for the last government? Because we in the PNM, we don't see office as an opportunity for fame and fortune. We see government as an opportunity for service. And that's where our councillors lie. There's a big difference, big, big difference. And I say to you tonight, after 60 years, after 60 years, you deserve to acknowledge the PNM as a venerable national institution. And it's not easy, but there's this boundless faith in our destiny that this country has a future, and a very bright future upon which we can all impact. If you are paid to clean the streets, then for heaven's sake, clean the streets. If you are paid to be a nurse or a doctor in the hospital, be there and for heaven's sake, look after the patients. And if you are paid to be minister or prime minister, then for heaven's sake, do what's best for the country, and this country will be the best in the world. That's the basic principle. It is when you deviate from that and you want to get more than your fair share, and you get it dishonestly, and you get it for not working, that is what pulls the system down. Local government is an insurance against the worst of those kinds of things. Because the minute you are involved in devolution, you now will know close to you who is the best and who is performing. We will break the structure at the central level, make new arrangements to put within your area social service officers who will report to your corporation. Your social service officers will know who in your district should and must be getting old age pension, who is aged and infirm and needs certain kinds of help, who has children that are not properly looked after, where there are orphans, and so on and so on. And as the government help, as voted by Parliament, is attributed to your corporation, you will be required at your level to service these people. And then it comes right down to your face that you will know. If you're taking bread out of anybody's mouth, you will know exactly who's starving. You'll know them by name. That's what local government is all about. That's what we're offering to you. But to have expenditure taking place and you're only hearing about billions and millions and billions and millions and having no idea where it's going. We are now numb to the sound of billions, numb to the sound of millions. When in fact, in many instances, $100,000 is a fortune and $10,000 could make a difference. The last government was on the verge of awarding a contract to build a market, in Pinal? No, the Pinal Corporation, the corporation head office. $124 million. And I'm sure that would never have bothered any of you here in Sipario or in Pinal, because we all want an administrative office for the corporation in Pinal. And they say it will cost $124 million to have that. You change the government. Pinal will get its administrative complex for no more than $80 million. That is $34 million more than they would have paid. Minister Khan would have told you tonight if he had the time that when he was made Minister of Local Government, he met a series of contracts underway, and the cabinet stopped all of those contracts and had them retendered. And to a man, every contract came in at almost one third of the cost less. What does that tell you? What does that tell you? Tells you one thing, that had you not voted for the PNM last year and put the PNM in office, you would have been paying those millions for those items. So if you had no benefit whatsoever from the dividend that you voted a PNM government last year, see it in those millions. See it in the $1 billion we've got back from OAS, and see it in the road that we're gonna build from Point 14 up here and on the way to Port of Spain. So, what can I say to you? The PNM is here for the people of Trinidad and Tobago. So tonight, Fyzabad as part of the Sipario Corporation. I want to ask you, as leader of this country and the person leading the local government reform exercise, to support the PNM candidates on November 28th. So, those of you in Avocats and San Francisco North, your PNM candidate is Richard Gooding. Those of you in Brighton, Vesiny, your PNM candidate is Gerald Debisset. Those of you in Cedrus, your PNM candidate is Rashid Mohammed. Erin, your PNM candidate is Arlene Randall. Otaheite Ruthlack, your PNM candidate is Anand Ransomware Maharaj. Paloseco, your PNM candidate is one of the longest serving, most dedicated PNM candidates, and a candidate of which we in the PNM are very proud. We give you Christine Neptune, the experience. Siparia East, San Francisco South, you know your candidate. You heard him. You know your candidate. And she is Camille Greenwich Charles. Monday's here. We're giving you commitment. We're giving you loyalty. We're giving you a woman of class. We give you in Monday's here. We give you a person who you supported almost all the way to the parliament. But now you are going to put her in local government. We give you Eileen Applewhite Steele. And of course, tonight, you heard from the platform, the man that you supported the last time, who you will support this time, for Sipario West Fyzabad. We give you the one and only Maurice Alexander. So tonight, the PNM is in Charlie King Junction, and we're saying to you here and to all of the Sipario Corporation, Sipario is PNM, Sipario gone PNM. And as I return to Diego Martin, I want to stay in Diego Martin on the night of November 28th, and I want to hear a shout from Charlie King Junction. I want to hear the tassa, I want to hear the drums, and I want to hear, great is the PNM, great is the PNM, great is the PNM, and PNM has taken Sipario. For real,